Then he go to the German two times to inject the PRP, but result is still not so good. And then he back to Japan, and the doctor harvest the skin and the soft tissue from abdomen and put inside the lateral wall. Still not so good.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of the Rhinoplasty Podcast with me, Dr. Cameron McIntosh. We're in season 4 already. It's quite something. And we are already digging for gold. We are wanting to get nuggets out of guys and girls from around the world who are absolutely passionate about rhinoplasty. And my guest in today's episode is a man who I have been dying to meet for many years. We've actually only virtually met, but finally, I've got Tony Chui here with me in studio. It's great to have you here, Tony.
Nice to meet you, Kevin.
So Tony actually comes from Taipei, Taiwan, eh? And 4 years ago was the big International Federation of Facial Plastic Surgery Society meetings in Taiwan, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
Yeah. And now this year it's going to be with Roxana in Colombia.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Tony, it's this podcast is listened to all around the world. And we've got listeners who are exposed to all sorts of different people we interview. As a background, tell the listeners who you are and how you came to do what you do nowadays.
Okay. In the beginning, I'm an ENT doctor. And during my training, I focus on the radiology. So during the daily practice in medical center, I do a lot of the functional science plastic and septoplasty. Yes. And then my teacher suggested me to do some more facial plastic, something like that. So I go to learn the rhinoplasty from a cosmetic plastic surgeon in our country.
Yeah.
But during that time, most the dark plastic surgeon just open a small hole inside the nose and put the anesthetic inside.
Yes.
So, but I see the result is not so good. So I don't dare to start my rhinoplasty with this method.
So if I can interrupt you there. So the first time it's the plastic surgeons, they show you, you just need to pop in a piece of silicone in the nose.
Yeah.
So explain to me what you mean by the results weren't so good. Is it not just that it doesn't look good, or were there certain complications?
During the beginning, I just see the result is unnatural because the dosing is so thin.
Yes.
And because we are Asian people, yes, we have a big nose, a small nose and a big tip.
Yes.
But after you put a silicone, the tip becomes very sharp.
Yes.
It's unnatural to, yeah, so I think the result is not so good.
Okay.
But just as you said, the complication is after I do the rhinoplasty many years later, I solve a lot of problems from the silicone rhinoplasty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then, so what happened with your journey after that? I know off air we were speaking about that Dean Turiomi had a big influence on your career, but tell the listeners how that then changed.
Yes, in the beginning, the Dean Turiomi was invited to our country to demonstrate rhinoplasty.
Yeah.
I think the result is much better than the silicone rhinoplasty. So I go to United States to attend his training course.
Yeah.
And then I go to South Korea,
yeah,
to attend the Professor Dong Ha Zhang's training course.
Yes.
And back to Taiwan.
Yes.
But in the beginning, I don't dare to do the cosmetic rhinoplasty because I'm not sure my technique is enough to do that or not. So I have two patient source in the beginning. One is because some patients have a nasal obstruction. If you use, but if they are deviation on the dorsal part and caudal part, and we cannot solve it use the traditional septoplasty. So I would suggest that to do the functional rhinoplasty.
Mm-hmm.
And then some patients got trauma and sent to the ER to my clinic.
Mm-hmm.
I always do the correct back to the normal structure for them.
Mm-hmm.
So I think for beginner, this is two souls to try to change or improve your technique in the beginning. Yeah.
And then since then, where, how much work do you now do in terms of functional and cosmetic work?
In nowadays, I think the functional part is maybe 30%.
Okay.
70% is the cosmetic part.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And the cosmetic part, maybe more than half is the revision rhinoplasty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. And Tony, tell me, we also spoke briefly about the empty nose syndrome.
Yeah.
Tell me more about that.
Okay. Yes, I think it's a very interesting story because a woman, he just received two or three times septoplasty, try to resolve her nasal obstruction.
Yes.
But the condition become worse and worse. And some patients have a caudal and the high septal deviation. And I do the prefer the functional rhinoplasty and got good result was reported by the newspaper. So she see the newspaper and come to my clinic, want me to do the functional rhinoplasty for her. But after detailed physical examination, I think she's not really the caudal and the high septal deviation. His nasal cavity is just total empty.
Really?
So yeah. I think this must be kind of an empty nose syndrome.
Yes.
But during that time, I don't have an experience about that. So I just write an email to the doctor, Yong Joo Jang in South Korea, because I just heard his speech about empty nose syndrome in an international meeting. And he just explained to me how to make the diagnosis and how to treat the patient.
Yeah.
So I told the woman, very honest, this is my first case. You want to try or not?
Okay.
Yeah. So I think I'm lucky. She said, you will try. So I used the ear cartridge for her to put inside, create a new inferior terminator for her.
Okay.
And she become better after that.
So explain that to me. So the turbinate has been severely reduced.
Yeah.
Do you then make an incision and you place that cartilage inside the mucosa?
Okay. This is why I say, because in the beginning, most doctor is make an incision on the lateral wall.
Yes.
And put maybe maple or cartridge inside.
Okay.
Or maybe the nasal floor. But the first case, I follow the route, put on the lateral wall. But after more case, I think maybe because I think the position we put the cartridge in not the natural anatomy.
Mm-hmm.
So just as you say, nowadays, I just make an incision on the residual of the inferior terminate and open a pocket and put the cartridge inside. So try to augmentation the residual inferior terminate instead of create a new inferior terminate.
So it's like paradoxical where the patient's complaining about obstruction, and so you're actually building up more into the nose to, in a way, obstruct the nose, but it relieves the patient's symptoms.
Yes. So in the beginning, empty nose syndrome is not convincing for a lot of doctors. Let's see, more space, why they induce the obstruction.
Yeah.
But after I read the paper and I'm lucky, I mean the Dr. Eugene Kerr.
Yes.
From the United States.
Yes.
He's the person, the doctor who created the empty nose syndrome, the term.
Absolutely.
Yeah, during that time, I meet him and I talk about something about the empty nose syndrome. So, and he encouraged me to do the cartridge on the inferior terminate instead of the lateral wall. Yeah. So, now that I put more and more cases in this way.
Yeah.
And I solve some patient. I have one patient here from Japan. And he's a very, for me, he made me very, I see my method is good because in the beginning he go to United States to put a thermal, the epidermal in a little wall.
Okay.
And but the result is not so good. And then he go to the German two times to inject the PRP, but result is still not so good. And then he back to Japan, and the doctor harvest the skin and the soft tissue from abdomen and put inside the little wall.
Wow.
And still not, the result is not so good. And a lot of doctor put the filler, just inject into the inferior terminal, try to increase the volume of light, but it's still not good. And he just communication with me via the email. And finally, he want to try my method to put a cartridge in the residual inferior terminator.
Yes.
And he come to my country. And after the operation, he just emailed me. He improved a lot after the so many times operation. So I think augment the residual inferior terminator, the result is better than the lateral wall. Because in the previous doctor just put on the lateral wall.
Yes, yes.
But still have some problem after it maybe have years till now. He just discussed with me and want to do some revision. So maybe I need to revise my method. And I do more case. Maybe I will publish my paper next year.
Wow.
And hope the result is okay.
No, I'm sure. Tony, that's fascinating. Okay, I've got one last topic I want to chat to you about before we wrap it up is, in Europe and possibly in North and South America, there's been this resurgence of preservation rhinoplasty. Now, the African population and the Asian population, we are mostly augmenting noses. We're not making noses smaller necessarily.
Yeah.
So I'm very interested to know from your experience and where you are in Taiwan now, how do these preservation rhinoplasty techniques have an influence on your surgeries?
Okay. And yes, I'm also lucky because 7 years ago, the Isa Bang invited me to the Nice,
yes,
to attend his preservation rhinoplasty course. And during that time, he asked me to talk about some complication of a structural rhinoplasty. And during the meeting, I learned a lot of surgeons from all over the world to talk about their different methods about the preservation rhinoplasty. And after the meeting, Isabang invited me to his home and have an afternoon tea. And he just talked about maybe he tried to create some new method, just as you said, for the small nose.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, in general, preservation, the push down.
Yes.
Maybe he want to push up.
Yes.
And we just talk about how to do that for the Asian patient, but I think still a long way to go. And after I back to Taiwan, I have discussed with Isa Bang, but nowadays I just try some reduction from the foreigner patient in our country. But I think maybe we will try to use this technique on the Asian patient in the future.
Awesome. Well, Tony, thank you so much, man. It's lovely to finally meet you and to be able to chat. And the listeners around the world, I hope you guys have enjoyed it. Remember, at the end of this year, we have the World Rhinoplasty Day again, which we're all very excited about. But Tony, thank you so much for your time and go well. God bless, man.
Okay. Thank you for the invitation. This is my great honor to be here.
Great. Thanks. For those of you who are only listening to this on a podcast platform, please try and reach out and get onto YouTube, because on our YouTube channel, we've got some really cool clips where I interview the guests.